Welcome to an interview with Melissa Larina, the podcast for executives who go after what they want with curiosity, creativity, and courage. Hi, I'm Melissa. I'm a career strategist, and I want to help you shift your focus from landing a job at a Fortune 500 company to finally figuring out how you can build your own billion-dollar career. Sounds good? Then keep listening. Today on an interview with Melissa Larina.
I spend 6 to 10 minutes on everything I post. I think about it. I read it carefully. I triple check it. I believe that what I do on social media can get me fired today, can get me divorced today, can get me in trouble today. And therefore, I take extra care. And doesn't mean I don't make mistakes. Doesn't mean I don't have terrible tweets. All of that's true. But you want to think about, what are you doing on Twitter? What are you doing on social? What are you giving out in the world? Is it going to be positive, or are you just going to be complaining about the food you served at the restaurant? Like, so you can think about different ways of doing that. There are ways in which you can complain about food at a restaurant, you know, like in Yelp, and that's the place for that. But you can use your Facebook and your Twitter and Instagram for other things, right? So like that, find your pathway. Find the way that works for you. And there's nobody can, I mean, people can be guided and can give you ideas, but at the heart of it, you alone can build out your strategy.
Meet Sri Srinivasan. He's the inaugural Marshall R. Loeb Visiting Professor of Digital Innovation at Stony Brook University School of Journalism in New York. He co-founded Digimentors, where he's a consultant, and he's been the Chief Digital Officer of major institutions, including the City of New York, Columbia University, and the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Before that, he spent 20 years as a full-time professor at Columbia Journalism School. He was named one of Fast Company's 100 most creative people in business and the world's most influential chief digital officer by the CDO Club. Every Sunday, you can catch him at 8:30 a.m. Eastern, and it's been for the last 4 years now, hosting a New York Times read-along, where he reads the print version of the New York Times out loud on Facebook Live. He's had various guests from various fields. I am so excited to have this conversation with Sri. Enjoy it. So Sri, thank you so, so much for agreeing to have this conversation with me. I know that you're coming to us all the way from New York City. So I'm really excited because when I first met you, it was actually during your social media weekend. Could have been maybe like 3 years ago or something like that. And it was such an amazing experience. And I know that this year you're also kind of gearing up to have another social media weekend. So I figured we would start the conversation around first giving the audience a sense of like what your big ambition is around social media weekend. And then maybe if you could share a funny moment or a story about that moment.
Thanks so much for having me. I'm delighted to be here and to talk to you all the way in Australia. I went to high school in Fiji. So Australia, New Zealand are the centers of the universe, and people barely think about America or even their old colonial masters in England anymore, but they really care about Australia and New Zealand. And so I have great memories of spending time in Australia, and I was last there in 2014. So it's been 5 years plus since I've last visited Australia. In terms of social media weekend, that's where we met last, as you said, and it's my premise that everybody in the world can benefit from social media training and conversation and help. The technology changes so quickly that it's worth meeting in person and talking and getting to understand what the different tools are and the platforms and what's working and what's not. And so we've been doing Social Media Weekend since 2011. And every time we get together, the idea is that I talk and share my ideas, but we use the convening power of having everybody in one room to find what's next, what's worth knowing, what should be ignored, et cetera. And I learn as much in these things as anybody else does. And in terms of moments. Anytime you get all these people together, there's always something fun happening. But it's a kind of bittersweet memory that we had April Rain, who is this amazing activist and social media thought leader. By the way, that's something that other people say about you. It's not a title you give yourself, but she created the hashtag OscarsSoWhite. And here we are all these years later, and Oscars are still so white. Mm. And we are just coming off the Oscars for this year. And so that's on my mind. And when we met with April, when she was one of my keynotes, we talked about how, you know, this wouldn't be an issue anymore because it would be solved by 2020. Here we are, and nothing's been solved yet. So it tells you that as many intentions there may be among people to bring change and accelerate change, that it happens very slowly when it counts. And one of my favorite expressions is that I'm all for progress. It's change I cannot stand. And that's often what you get a feeling when you're trying to change institutions, as April was doing. And her Twitter handle, by the way, is Reign of April, R-E-I-G-N of April. That's her Twitter handle.
Wow. I remember when she was there, and I remember there was an audience member who was so, like, I think he was calling himself a fanboy or something like that of April. And I remember when that hashtag was circulating. And it's interesting because now being in Australia, you would think for like those mega events, I would still be plugged in. But honestly, for me, it's kind of refreshing to see from a distance kind of all the hoopla, you know, amongst all these like major events in the United States. But also it's given me a sense of appreciation for the fact that the world is actually looking, you know, like it's actually like a buzz in the air here. And so it's something that I hadn't noticed from, you know, when I was in the United States. But I appreciate that story because I remember that moment. And I remember how big a deal that was, that hashtag and the sentiment around some of the talent and kind of feeling left out in, you know, in their dreams a lot of times, their creative ambitions. And so Sri, in terms of that idea and just really feeling left out, something that I wanted to learn a little bit more about was ultimately you have this huge social media presence. It's something that you either eased into or you just like threw yourself in. Why don't you tell us a little bit about how that journey evolved for you, and then maybe help us understand, you know, how it's something that is available to people who might not feel as courageous, bold, or be, and I'm assuming, extroverted.
Well, I've never been accused of being an introvert, but I think you're referring in part to my unusual story in terms of dealing with changes. We were talking about change just now. How do you deal with changes in your own life? And I was a professor of journalism for 20 years at Columbia University. And then I took this amazing job as the first chief digital officer of the Metropolitan Museum of Art, the world's largest encyclopedic museum, and an amazing institution here in New York City. And I gave up kind of everything I knew to go work at an institution where they'd never hired someone like me who knew nothing about art to run such an important role. And I ran a 70-person team doing digital and mobile and all this cool stuff. And I had a great time. And I have a hashtag, 3 Met Years, the number 3 Met Years. If you check that out, you will see how amazing the time was. But I'm also giving away the story because I was only there for 3 years. And one day I was brought in and told I'm leaving the Met. And I certainly had no plans to tell anybody that I am, you know, I'm out of work, because not something that you naturally want to tell anyone. But I ended up going on Facebook and telling people I've lost my job. And I gave people a Google form to fill in. And more than 1,400 people around the world filled in this form. Wow. And there were some good ideas and some terrible ideas, and just, it was the worst moment of my life, but also the best moment of my life, where I had this incredible global digital hug from strangers and friends around the world, including Australia and everywhere, who people just reached out and said they want, you know, just wanted to help. And what I learned from that process is that there is so much you can do if you express what help you need. Often people who are looking for work, who are transitioning, they try to keep it all kind of close to them. And even their own friends don't know exactly what they can do. And so being very clear about the help you need, people will help you. That's one of the things I've learned. And so I then became the chief digital officer of New York City. And then I now work for myself. I have a social media and digital consulting business, and I teach 2 days a week at Stony Brook University. And all of this is to say that I have benefited enormously from having a network, from connecting with people. And if nothing else today, I hope everybody who watches will use my story to build their network when they don't need it. Meaning you don't need a big social media network, but you need to start working on it and looking for help and connections before you need it. Because once you need it, it's almost too late. And that's why if you grow your digital community, your digital footprint on a regular basis, grow that out, then when you have the emergency, then people can come to help you. And that's how I would look at it. My work today as a consultant is helping people with that balance between what I call their real life footprint and their digital footprint. And if you are not matching those, then you're leaving opportunities, money, and more on the table. And so that's what I encourage everybody to do, is to just reinforce those connections with your network, a friend you haven't called in a long time, a mentor, a would-be mentor, just drop them a note. It takes 10 seconds. You can text them, you can WhatsApp them, you can DM them, anything. It doesn't matter. Just make those connections and deepen your network and grow your network before you need it.
And I mean, I can't emphasize enough, Sri, what you're suggesting. I feel almost like a broken record, to be very honest, because as someone who is, you know, coaching marketing professionals and, you know, helping them ultimately do for themselves what they do for, you know, products and services, there's this disconnect. It's like when the house is on fire, that is when you get the hose, right? It's none of this preventative fire resistant material building stuff that they really take to heart. And the reason why I've at least come to realize that people don't do it, and I've asked them directly, is they say, I know that I would help someone if they asked me. However, I don't want to be either a burden, or I don't want to ask for help because I'm afraid I'm going to get rejected or hurt. I mean, it's more like an emotional sort of struggle. And so I'm curious because, I mean, I watched your PBS interview and there was a moment that you mentioned that you were a little hesitant to, you know, just put yourself out there and publish. Going back to that moment, what thought was going in your mind? Like, what were you thinking that made you feel hesitant to hit, you know, submit?
Yeah, you're talking about a PBS, which is a big American network. They came out here and they followed me for a whole day from 6:30 a.m. till 7 p.m. as I went around looking for work and talking to people and meeting mentors and all of that stuff. And I'm sure we can link to it and people can find it also. And in it, I said that a lot of people have given me great credit for this. Even now, just this week, I get inquiries from people asking for job advice and everything. And everybody says, we can't do what you did. And I don't want anybody to do what I did. What I did on a scale of 1 to 10 was a 25 in terms of being open and projecting. And it's way over the top. But I tell people you can do a 1 or a 2 or a 3 on a scale of 1 to 10. And that means exactly what you're saying, reaching out and asking for help. And I was hesitant because it's very difficult to do. It's not a natural human tendency, especially on social, where you're trying to curate this perfect life. You're always showing off how much fun you're having, all this cool food you're drinking, eating and drinking, and the beaches you're at. Like, that's what we are projecting. Everybody's so happy on social. And being vulnerable, having issues, sharing that is very rare. And so that's why I was hesitant. And the fact that you work with marketing professionals who do this for a living for products and services and their companies, they need to be better at this than everybody else. One of the things that I always look at when I hire marketing people, and I do a lot of work with marketing folks as well, is I say, if you're bad at telling your own story, why would you be good at telling my story for my business, whatever my business is that I'm hiring for? It makes no sense, right? Because if your story is the most important story of all, and you have, you're bad at it, then it's a problem. Now, some people compare it to, you know, the cobbler's children have no shoes. So first of all, I wouldn't hire a cobbler like that anyway. He's not taking care of his children, so that's a problem. But second, it's not about the children in this case. It's about you and what you can do. And if you're not applying the techniques and tools of modern marketing to your own story, in part so that you can work on your own story, so you can learn what's new, what's different. When I hire a CMO or I work with a CMO, I'm expecting her or him to help me craft my products. When I'm hiring them inside for another client, I expect them to be a leader in that world, to guide the CEO, to guide folks along the way. And if I notice that they're not on LinkedIn, they're not on Twitter, they don't have to have a huge network. They don't have to be super like posting every day or an influencer or anything like that. But they do need to be experimenting, testing. And again, when they don't do it for their own story, then I worry about people like that. So let this be a wake-up call that you've been, as you said, you've been repeating this again and again, but there's an endorsement from whatever it is, 10, 15,000, 20,000 miles away.
100%. I basically compare it to like an always-on strategy as a marketer. Just have an always-on strategy, some sort of consistent social media presence, so that should something change, you're not left without some sort of next step, some sort of connection, some sort of relationship. Mm-hmm. And on that note that you mentioned earlier, as far as there being, you know, a plethora of tools, techniques, experimenting, you know, with your own social media efforts, I'm curious because, I mean, you must consume so much information around social media in terms of what's working, what's not, what's new, and all these different ways that you can use it. How do you, in a very tactical and in control way, process this information and bring it from, okay, input to some sort of like output that benefits your brand?
It's a great question and something that I've been thinking about. Part of it is that you don't want to be overwhelmed by all of this. And I wrote an article in June of 2000 about how we were at peak communications and that basically we had no more room for more things in our lives. And this was before people were texting. This is before Twitter, before Facebook, before Instagram, before TikTok, before LinkedIn, all of these things that have now eaten up my life. And I still felt like we were already overwhelmed and way too much information. So I find that amusing. And what I try to do is not try to figure out everything myself, but surround myself in my network by people who are experts on these things and who share information. And then I absorb and understand based off of what they're doing. One of the great skills you can have in the 21st century is to be a great pointer and curator of information, pointing to things that are useful. Often when people say they, you know, when I ask them to do things on Twitter or have a blog or any of those things, they say, oh, I don't have time. But I always think of, are there things that you can share? Can you point to, even if you don't have to write original content to be successful online? You could be pointing with credit to other things, and you can, that there's great value in that. I run a Facebook group that I invite everybody to join called Sree's Advanced Social, S-R-E-E apostrophe S, Advanced. So Sree's Advanced Social, if you just search it right on Facebook, you can find it. You can ask to join. It's a group of 9,000 plus people around the world who work in social, in digital, including senior people at Facebook, at Twitter, at LinkedIn, etc. And they are there to help all of us, and we help each other. And so that's a perfect way to keep up with things. And you should all have some version of that in your field where you are in a group and smarter people than you point things out that then you pay attention to. Because you can't rely on your Facebook feed to tell you things because the Facebook feed is too wide. Your Twitter feed is too wide. So these groups are really important. And I have developed I'm just working on my presentation for Social Media Weekend. This idea that you want to think about these, you know, in everything else in social media, it's about broadcasting, about mass appeal, reaching as many people as possible. Great. But look at those as kind of big C communications. Now I'm also focused on what I call small C communications and talking in small groups on WhatsApp, on DM groups on Twitter, on DM groups inside Facebook Messenger, different places for different things, some on Instagram, different micro communities. I mean, tiny, some could be 6 people, some could be 30, some could be 50, and developing different conversations of different levels of deepness, a different kind of cadence and volume that's very different from your large platforms. And I believe there is so much to learn there. When people ask, when I tell them I have a lot of niche groups I work on, somebody said, wait, well, what is the most unusual niche group? And I tell people, how about dads, media dads of twins? So these are fathers who work in the media who have twin children. We will switch to parents of twins when we get our first female mother who says she wants to be in this group. And just a handful of us, but just shows you how you can have very specific small group interactions that have deep, deep potential.
That is so cool. I know here just this week, my identical twins and my singleton, they're in a Montessori school. And just week, the class parent created a WhatsApp group for all the parents of the kids in this, you know, 6 to 9 classroom. Mm-hmm. And it sounds very similar to what you're suggesting in terms of having that deeper, it's almost like you have these shared experiences and shared interests. And so the conversation can be very specific and focused, which is interesting.
Yeah, absolutely. And hey, if you want to join us, then you suddenly become our, we can change that to mothers, I mean, parents of media, parents of twins.
Yeah, I'd be down. That'd be cool. I wanted to ask you, just because of your global reach and because of your LinkedIn profile, so you have Chinese characters in your name. I'm curious, what was the rationale behind including that? Do you speak that language? I can't tell if it's Cantonese or Mandarin or some other language, but what's kind of behind that?
Well, precisely to have this conversation, that's why it's there. I'm very much interested in working in China, working in and around China, and I've done that. I do that on occasion, and it's in Mandarin, and it's my name made into Mandarin characters by my friends. My best friend is Chinese American, but my 16-year-old son is very much interested in China. He's learning Mandarin. He has spent 3 weeks there this summer away from his twin, a sister for the first time for that long. And just having that there gives me an opportunity to have connections or conversations with people that can benefit me, can benefit my son. And just, you know, this is the one of the largest, most important societies, communities in the world, and you want to kind of be connected to them. Over at both Stony Brook and at Columbia, where I was, Chinese students are among our largest group of students. And so anytime I do a workshop, and having those Chinese characters kind of simultaneously reduces the temperature because they feel a connection, but the opposite also happens, where they then think I can speak Mandarin. And then I get bombarded with questions, emails, texts, etc. And I have to say, stop, I can't speak Mandarin. But it becomes an icebreaker in this weird way. Also, I'm on WeChat, which is a channel that is critical in China. But most Americans, and I don't know about Australia, but most Americans are not on it. But just like, wait, look, most Americans are not even on WhatsApp. And somebody just did an article, What's with Americans and WhatsApp? Asking why more Americans who don't have international connections or have lived overseas, work overseas, they're not on WhatsApp. And so that'd be a shock to most Australians and people in the world who use WhatsApp. You know, it's the most successful of all the tools because they have more than 2 billion customers, bigger than Facebook. Of course, it's part of Facebook too.
No, absolutely. And so that's really interesting because you just gave me an idea originally, in terms of the conversations that I have with clients who want to work abroad or want to work, you know, in different states, like I would say, okay, so make sure that you might have an address in that location. Let's just imagine that you can point an employer to. But now what you just said just gave me an idea. Like if you're interested in working in, and I'm making this up, in France or something, and there's something that can serve as an indicator, let's say online, why not use it, right?
And here's one that you can use very specifically. I got this idea 2008, so 12 years ago. I went to do some workshops, 3 weeks of workshops in Argentina. And I don't speak Spanish, and all my workshops had simultaneous translators, etc. Or people spoke fluent English, so it wasn't a problem. But on LinkedIn, you can create a second profile in your main account, a second profile, and a third one in other languages. So that's a great way to introduce yourself. So if you want to work in France, create a French one. Of course, if you want to work in France and you don't speak French, you're going to have trouble because the French really care about this. But I'm just saying in general, you could have that second account. You could hire someone to write, you know, translate your entire bio and you stick it on there. Make sure you say also, you know, you're not a French speaker or you're an early, you know, you're a light French speaker, whatever, learning, beginner, etc. But that just, it's a courteous thing to do, even if you don't speak the language, is to help your audience. And if I were doing a social media speaking tour of China, as I done, I would convert your resume into Chinese so that people can distribute it. And it's all about making people feel comfortable, and giving them that opportunity is really important.
And I think it's also, it's unexpected, because someone might not necessarily see other people that might be in the US, let's say, being that generous, you know, and like having their name translated or having a document translated. And it's such a sign of like, you know, you matter and I value your opinion and I actually want you to understand what I am sharing with you. And so I think that's just good business practice in this global, you know, environment that we're in. And I think, again, you know, having this experience of being outside of the US at some point in your life can be extremely valuable. And so from that angle, out of curiosity, in terms of the students that you have now and the students that have walked through the doors at Columbia University, not just people that are from outside of the United States, but anyone that maybe had their own American dream that they wanted to make happen, did that idea of just having dreams as an adult kind of rub off on you or inspire you or kind of give you a new perspective as an adult who dreams maybe in a different way from a career perspective? I'm curious.
The American dream is certainly something a lot of people have. By the way, one of the Scandinavian prime ministers just said that the best place to achieve the American dream is now in her country, in Scandinavia, which tells you something about how the world is changing. But I came to this country as a 9-year-old. My father was an Indian diplomat. So I was born in Tokyo, lived in Bhutan and the former Soviet Union, and then came here at 9, spent time in India in between. And all along the way, I learned about kind of the good things about America and some of the problems as well. And I was very much interested in working and living here. But I would also say that at the same time, I teach people that you want to live and work where the best opportunities are for you, where you are. And it's not just money. It's what you're, where you learn the most, where you do your best work. I find way too many people come to America and sacrifice their careers to take small jobs because they want to live here. Now, it's one thing if you're doing it for your kids or escaping a terrible situation. I'm not talking about that. But I'm talking about people who graduate from great schools in America and then desperately hang on and aren't really thinking about, are there other places that would welcome their skills? Are there states in America? You know, like clinging on to working in New York, where they have this idea that, you know, media capital, et cetera. But there'd be a much bigger fish in a different pond. And I'm always encouraging people to do that. And not everybody can because of the way our, my, you know, immigration laws are and everything else. And that's why it's, as someone said on Twitter, imagine having a passport that lets you work in 27 countries with no restrictions and tearing it up and throwing it away. Like, it just boggles the mind that the Brits would do that via Brexit. But that's the world we live in now.
Totally different perspective. And it's interesting because for me, I am, some would say second generation, some would say third, depending on how you would qualify my grandparents. But my grandparents were the ones that went to the United States. On my mom's side, they were in Puerto Rico, so they were still in the United States. And then from my dad's side, Cuba. And so it's, I mean, they left for their children, their families, the future generations in terms of from poverty to, you know, real sidewalks and real homes and everything. So it was different. And so a lot of people would question me and my family's decision to leave the United States and go to Australia. Because it's like, well, wait a minute. And God forbid we would ever want to go and be in like Puerto Rico or something. It's like, we got out of there and you're going back. But it's been an interesting change of atmosphere. And what you're saying is so right. And I had a client who was in a similar situation. She actually came from China and she had this amazing job working for a car financing company in China. It was a US company. She came to the US and the opportunities for her as a marketer with a master's and knowing English, although it wasn't her native language, the opportunities weren't as exciting as if she had stayed in China. It was, she was being overlooked in so many different situations because she had the, you know, Chinese specific experience, which was absurd because, you know, it was really a matter of her doing things or making lemonade with lemons ultimately. And the inability sometimes of employers in the US to really see that as extremely valuable also in the United States. But ultimately, it was just an interesting transition for her because she experienced that frustration, but she came to the US for love. So she wasn't going to leave. And she had just been a new mom. But it's interesting because I hope that from a US perspective, regardless of the elections, regardless of what happens, my hope is that employers, when they do interview someone, let's say from an emerging country, for instance, they gain this sense of deep appreciation for the fact that the results that they had in that emerging country, as one example, are as valuable, if not more valuable, than someone in the US who has a myriad of resources and, you know, maybe access and, you know, all of the stuff that we have and might take for granted. So Sri, the other question that I had for you was in terms of this fact. So I am really, really interested in learned helplessness and learned helplessness from the perspective of, you know, once you maybe take a step forward on social media, let's say, and I'm kind of changing the topic a little bit, but if in social media you've been burned in the past, how can you think about your reentry strategy, let's say, from a social media perspective? Because a lot of people, they also feel that, you know, either trolls might comment on something and say something that's disheartening, or even their family might say, well, who do you think you are for showing off your accolades or whatever on social media? So I'm just kind of curious, like, how can one think about that and continue to benefit from social media?
I think it's having a strategy about what you're posting and what you're sharing. As I said, you don't have to talk about yourself. There's a famous formula that someone uses called 411, where out of every six posts, four actually have nothing to do with you, where you're talking about other people, other services, other things. And then only two are about you. And one of them is a very important, deep piece. One is a kind of a lighter, more fun piece. So there are ways to do that where you are talking about other things. And that gives you, see, what happens is when you post very rarely, then each post is fraught with danger and potential problems. But if you post 3 days a week or three times a day, then, you know, you make a mistake here or you have a problem there. It doesn't matter. It all kind of, you know, because there's more content. But it's when you're posting very little, when you're being so shy that it becomes harder and harder to make that each post because you're trembling with fear as you post them. But I should tell you that I post like that, you know, 10 times a day. I spend 6 to 10 minutes on everything I post. I think about it. I read it carefully. I triple check it. I believe that what I do on social media can get me fired today, can get me divorced today, can get me in trouble today. And therefore, I take extra care. And doesn't mean I don't make mistakes. Doesn't mean I don't have terrible tweets. All of that's true. But you want to think about, what are you doing on Twitter? What are you doing on social? What are you giving out in the world? Is it going to be positive? Or are you just going to be complaining about the food you served at the restaurant? Like, so you can think about different ways of doing that. There are ways in which you can complain about food at a restaurant, you know, like in Yelp. And that's the place for that. But you can use your Facebook and your Twitter and Instagram for other things, right? So like that, find your pathway. Find the way that works for you. And there's nobody can, I mean, people can be guided and can give you ideas, but at the heart of it, you alone can build out your strategy.
I think it's interesting. Again, it's like with a lot of the marketers, this is what they do for brands, but they're very, very hesitant to do it for their own personal brand. I wanted to ask you about something that is a part of your community. So it's a little different than we've just talked about, and it's the New York Times read-alongs. So why don't you share a little bit about, you know, how that idea came up and why you decided it would be a great habit to kind of keep executing upon?
Yeah, so this was an experiment. So I have this idea. I tell people, be a late adopter, but an early tester of technology. A late adopter, but early tester. And so I'm constantly testing things. And I love print. I got my first byline at the Fiji Sun when I was 16 years old. And I knew this is what I want to do the rest of my life, write articles and stuff. And so I built out this experiment where I would start reading the Sunday New York Times, which is an iconic edition of the iconic newspaper in New York, and just read it on Facebook Live and talk about where the pictures are and point the camera. And I just started doing that on a whim 4 years ago. And now it's become much more real in the sense that my friend Neil Parikh stepped in and took what was an experiment and built it into something that matters, that helps thousands of people, that has its own audience. We were just talking to a sponsor today about how we take it to the next level. And so it's an appointment viewing, 8:30 a.m. Eastern time. And that means, you know, it's in the evening in many parts of the world. But we read the Sunday New York Times with a guest most often, and then sometimes with someone from the New York Times itself. And I knew we had made a mark when the travel editor of the New York Times 4 years ago joined me on a read-along. And now her successor the other day invited us into her home to sit and read the New York Times with her, which is incredible. And we have nothing to do with the New York Times. And that's also important because then we can criticize it. And we can say, we don't like the story. We don't like the placement. We can ask questions. If it was part of the New York Times, then it would not be real in the way this is real. And so that's sort of how I think about this and believe the opportunity there is for all of us. So every Sunday evening in Australia, if you have a few minutes, just find me on Facebook. We also put it now on LinkedIn and we also put it on YouTube. So the idea is just kind of keep increasing that audience and get it out there and also celebrate print, you know, in 10, 15 years, it'll be gone. But we will look back and remember this moment of how the world got connected in so many interesting ways. And none of this is to say there aren't obviously problems with social media. There are terrible things. All of that's true. But I am an optimist and believe that the future of these communications things is filled with problems and potential, and the potential outweighs the problem.
I find it fascinating because I've attended some of the read-alongs. And So it's really interesting to just almost be in someone's, you know, home and watch them like share their opinion and have those conversations. And I'm just curious, has the New York Times like made edits like because of this? Have there been things that have really shifted their way of thinking or?
Oh, no. I mean, they get so much criticism every day from, they get feedback from at least hundreds of people every day in real time from all over the world. So I certainly don't know of anything, but I do know that the editors read us. We even went to the home of the print editor of the New York Times in New Jersey and read the paper with him, which was like an incredible moment. And the fact that there is a print editor of the New York Times, whose job it is to make sure that print edition is beautiful and works every day, is fantastic. So the more we can bring people together around a shared community and shared interest, it's also a thing that I have shown other industries that they can do their own version of this. Whatever the touchstones are in their industry. In mine, of media and communications, print means something. But if you're a doctor, maybe there's a special thing that happens three times a year in your business. You could talk about that and have a conversation around it. And people love hearing conversations with interesting people. And that's the key to making these things work.
I totally agree. And some of the things that I've heard from people who are hesitant to kind of be out there is that they don't think they're interesting enough or that they have something interesting to say.
Yeah, so I believe the exact opposite. You may have seen when you were here, CBS has a series of short stories they do called Everyone Has a Story. And I believe that I can get interviews because I've been doing this since I was 16. I can get anyone to talk if they're willing to talk. Everybody has an interesting story and everyone is interesting and relevant and useful and helpful to the world. It can be relevant and helpful and useful to the world. So I'm a big believer in these conversations. And that's why I'm always happy to do them when people ask.
And thank you for the opportunity. I mean, I wanted to ask you one last question, and it has to do with a job interview sort of question. And so here's the question. And in terms of the value that people bring to the table, these are different communities that you've expressed in some of your TEDx talks. So you might want to describe a little bit, you know, in terms of these communities once I read out the question. So how can companies who currently have a mix of traditional experts and tradigitals, as well as native digitals, create more opportunities where the best ideas can rise to the top and ultimately win the day? So you might want to help us understand those different communities, traditional experts, tradigitals, and natives.
Experts, yeah, so traditional experts are exactly what it is. These are the people who know your industry really well, have not just the traditional skills of your industry, but also have the ethics and values and traditions of the industry and know who's who and what the connections are. They're really important. They're also the digital natives, the digital folks who've grown up digitally, who are very relevant to your business because they know all the cutting edge stuff and they know the new stuff. But the people I'm really focused in on, what one of my colleagues coined the term, the tradigital people, tra-digital, traditional and digital overlaid together. And notice the first word is traditional. And that means they have all of that background and skills, but they have the new vocabulary, the new way of understanding, the new way of connecting, and they put that on top of their digital skills, their traditional skills, and can have a real impact. So I think there is plenty of ways in which a company can nurture all three groups and get everybody to become that second group. A lot of millennials and younger people think they know everything technology-wise and often don't. And on the flip side, a lot of people who are older, if you think they can't learn the new stuff, but they can. And everybody needs to work together to make that happen. I just saw a book today. It said The Making of a Millennial Baby Boomer. This is a millennial guy started kind of doing reverse mentoring with a bunch of baby boomers and in the process became kind of an older person himself, but also learned a lot. And those two communities kind of came together. So that was kind of fun.
Is there like a company that you know of that maybe has gotten that right, has been able to kind of bring the different communities together and just have, you know, come up with the best in class ideas?
Well, you know, I think a lot of the big companies are now working in that direction. I just saw today that IBM announced that they're moving their entire business onto Slack. And I'm sure there are people at IBM who are like, oh no, this is too complicated. And others saying we only want to live in Slack. And so that's an example of a traditional company converting people and bringing them all along. And I learned this myself in 1994 when our dean at our journalism school at Columbia said, we're moving to email. And there was no vote, there was no debate. And in this kind of undemocratic move, she moved the entire school onto email and changed us for the better forever.
Thank you for that. Sri, it's been amazing having this conversation. I'm so grateful for your insights, your time, your speedy response. I mean, unbelievable. I appreciate you, your wisdom, and I really hope that social media weekend turns out to be like absolutely outstanding. Totally outstanding.
Thank you so much. And maybe we'll bring social media weekend to Australia. We'd love to do that. My plan is to take this around the world, and maybe you and I can work on that one day. That'd be amazing. Which city are you in again?
I'm in Sydney.
Oh, nice. Very, very nice. Yeah.
It's very
cool. I haven't been to Sydney since 1988 or so. I've got to look up when the bicentennial cricket test matches were. I think would have been around that time. And that was the last time I was in Sydney.
Sydney's outstanding. I mean, of course.
I was 18 and now I'm going to be 50 this year. So life moves fast. You have children. One of my favorite sayings is the days are long, but the years are short. And it's true. Maybe. I had hair when I was in Sydney last.
Maybe it'll be full circle. It'll be when the twins are 18.
Yeah, there you go.
That'd be really cool. Thank you again for your time, Sri. Have an awesome evening.
And good luck to your audience. And if I can ever help anybody, I'm sri@sri.net on email. Email still matters, by the way. Don't let anybody tell you email is over. sri@sri.net on email, @sri on Twitter, @srinet on Instagram. And just be in touch. I'm always happy to help.
Thank you, Sri. My conversation with Sri was really pertaining to this notion that you need to have your own sense of a brand, and it needs to be untied from any individual employer. It's really incredibly important for you to think through, especially if you're a marketer, how you should be telling your story. What social media channels should you be definitely, you know, mastering your skill set in terms of networking? Who do you need to know? Who should you know? And how can you keep them consistently part of your circles? Also, pertaining to social media, just like any technology out there, it's really difficult to constantly be on the pulse of what's new and what's great. So you want to make sure that within your network, you have the right people who are experts in their specific niche, who can basically cut to the chase and tell you what's new and if it matters pertaining to whatever it is you need to accomplish. Then you have this notion of really thinking through how you can become a tradigital. And Sri mentions this at the very end, and it was part of that job interview question. And IBM does have its own initiatives right now, thereby making it a case study for, you know, really being able to take, you know, several employees who are well known and who understand how to win in a traditional organization, but ultimately bringing Slack instead of email as part of the conversation. And so that huge change from an organizational perspective is going to help bring about the best ideas. So is the plan, right? So it's important for you to think to yourself, how can I leverage the power of social media strategically so that I am not left behind in my career should something change in terms of my industry, my employer, or whether, frankly, your boss just wakes up on the wrong side of the bed. You want to make sure that you have some sort of personal brand and that it's sustainable. So I wish you so much success. Thank you. Now it's your turn. It's your turn to live courageously. It's your turn to follow your curiosity and use your creativity to take the next step towards living a purposeful life. And the next step is right here. I want to personally invite you, if you're a marketing professional, whether you work in a corporate setting or you work on the agency side, to schedule a 60-minute, absolutely free breakthrough session with me. Just go to melissalarena.com/sessions, melissalarena.com/sessions. It is during that 60-minute session that we will focus on your career today, or more specifically, the challenges that you're solving at work.
We'll also go through the sort of things that you would rather be solving for, the things that are closer to your heart, the products and services that you truly believe in that you would love to market instead. And we're also going to get down to the details. So what is it going to take to close the gap between what you're doing today in marketing versus what your dream marketing career consists of? The conversation is absolutely free. So apply for the call today because life is now. It is not later. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to an interview with Melissa Lorena. Want to learn more about me and how I can help you build your own billion-dollar career? Visit my website, melissalorena.com. In the meantime, I would love to hear your thoughts about this podcast. Please leave me a review on iTunes. Wishing you continued success. Until next time.